is we're going to understand a bit about mentoring, and we'll take it on from there. Now, so for a lot of us, okay, if you can't read it, it's okay. So for a lot of us, this is what we think of mentoring is like, right? Yeah, let me run through. Mentor and mentee match up. So there's a match up process. You know, we let you know what is the role of the mentor. After that, we let you know what is the role of the mentee. Then after that, we do a matchmaking. You know, have a proper meeting, set it in the calendar. We sit down and say, we explain to each other. As a mentor, here's my role. And as a mentee, your role, we explain. And what is the parameter? What is the concept? What can we talk? What can we not talk? And everything. So that is the first part. Okay, just to get to know each other. So we have this idea, that's the first part. And we have this idea that once we enter into the mentoring relationship, the second thing is, we have this process called initiation. Alright, then there's the whole thing called a structured meeting. So once again, we set it up in calendar, you know, meet at a place that's neutral, you know, not too quiet, not too noisy, make sure, you know, that we can talk properly, all these type of things. Then we have to build rapport, you know, hey, how's your family, oh, is my family okay, you know, those type of things. And then, we have a mentor-mentee agreement. Alright, so we will sign a document and say, you know, these are the things, you know, as my mentor, it lasts for 6 months, and you know, we agree that we meet once every Tuesday, every Tuesday, 5:30 to 7:30 PM, then we sign on it, you know. And then we got a logbook. Then we do a broad goal setting. So broad goal setting, okay, so as a mentee, what's your name, sorry? Okay, Juhan. So, all right, so as a mentee, Juhan, what do you want? Okay, you want this to achieve this, you want to achieve that, you know? What are the three goals? Okay, what are the timeline and everything? So then we have what we call a broad goal setting. And this part is just to initiate, just to start off. Then after that, we go into the whole area where it's called cultivation. We have specific goal setting. Now, Juhan, you have this big goal. Let's bring down the smaller goals. And then let's do a review. Every week we review. How far are you from this goal? Did you set a timeline? Is the milestone there? And then after that, we do action plan. Okay, you know, these are the part you need to do. This is the part I will do and help you as a mentor. And then we do a recap. So what did you do last week? Did you say you will do what we said you will do? Because we agreed that we will do. You know, then after that, you troubleshoot. Hey, what did you do that what we say you're supposed to do? And then after that, if you didn't do what you're supposed to do, is there a problem? No, let's talk about it because it's a part of our broad goal setting. And you know, here and this is our mentor and mentee agreement. We don't want to fail the agreement. So this is the part what we call cultivation. And it's along the way. And finally, it's called separation and redefinition. So it's like after 6 months, well, congratulations, let's check on it. You know, I'm your mentor, you're my mentee. You know, we have done it, you know, and then we have achieved some of your goals. But it doesn't matter, we have achieved some of the KPI now, up 1 to 5, tick 1, tick 3, tick 4 and 5, number 2, never achieved, never mind. Do you want to consider another 6 months? Then we start all over again that initiation. So this is our idea of mentorship. Very complicated, right? Very complicated. You can probably do a one semester subject on this, right? And take some exams and things like that. But in corporations, sometimes this is what mentorship is like in big corporations, in big organizations. But really, we're not here to talk about this. So just now some of your eyes are like, wow, go big again. Oh God, you know, Andrew's gonna talk to everyone of the circle. Die, sure die. No wonder 2 hours. Okay, no, we're not gonna talk about anything like that. But we're gonna talk about how people like you and me, how each and every one of us, we can do our mentor-mentee relationship in an informal. I just start off my adventure, you know. After the second 100 meters, then the lactic acid starts to build up in your legs, right? I think, like, oh, boy, are we, you know, is this going to be any much longer? I think it's like 200 meters, and we got 7.8 kilometers to go. And as we go along, what happens is that, you know, we keep asking, so what's going on? You know, when are we there? When are we there? So the guy will always tell us, just around the corner is the next stop. He says that for like 50, 60 times. You know, just around the corner, just around the corner, just around the corner. After for 4 hours of hiking, then we reach the first stop, you know. But the thing is, if he told us, you know, it's 4 hours more, what are we going to do? Oh, the one I feel, you know, let me sit down, I don't go up today, I don't go up, you know. I go back to Sabah, eat the seafood better, you know. I don't go up. So that's why the coach blindfolded it. But you can see that the coach was, in a sense, mentoring the captain, right? Correct, right? But of course, it's a bit more dramatic here because it's a movie, you know, there's a lot of shouting, don't ever give up on me, those type of things. But mentoring basically is a relationship between two persons where someone or another or the other person has something to share. something to share. And we will find out a bit more about mentoring, because a lot of us have this idea of mentoring that, you know, you need to be in a multinational organization, or you need to be 40, 50 years old, you know, that you need to have lived life very long, you need to have a PhD, then you can mentor someone else. So that is not the, that is not what mentoring should be like in the informal sense, okay? So we'll talk a bit more on that. Now, so a mentor is someone who allows you to see hope inside yourself, all right? And this is what Oprah Winfrey said. Okay, I'll just quickly go through mentoring for this guy. Everyone knows Steve Jobs? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, good. I was getting very afraid, okay? All right, so everyone knows Steve Jobs. Now let's look at who mentored Steve Jobs and who he mentored after that, all right? So let's have a look at who mentored Steve Jobs, and he's of course Apple's founder and ex-CEO, okay? Now, so there's this guy called Robert Noyce. He's the Microchip co-founder. So he founded the Microchip, okay? He taught Steve Jobs in the whole area of technology, all right? So this is Robert Noyce, okay? And the second guy was Robert Friedland. He's a, yeah, he's a drug dealer. So in campus, when Steve Jobs was at university campus like y'all, I don't know whether you got friends like that who sell drugs in the campus, hopefully not. But this guy is the guy that sells drugs. He sells like the marijuana, you know, LSD. Those like methamphetamine, something like that, all right? Ice, you get it? Wow, hey, this one, they shake their heads. More familiar topic for them, all right? Okay, I don't know, all right? I don't know if Kampa got nightclubs and y'all go and purchase this sort of thing. But anyhow, this guy taught Steve Jobs about selling. Steve Jobs is known in the world as one of the best salesmen ever to live, ever to live. If you go for Apple presentations, it's very awesome. But where he learned from was this guy called Robert Friedland. Bill Campbell, his football coach, taught him about excellence. Then we have Kobunji Otagawa, who's his Zen guru, taught him about simplicity. So the design of Apple phones, Apple products, it looks very simple and nice, right? So the influence came from this guy, Kobunji Otagawa. I got no idea who he is, you probably wouldn't know also, alright? That's where he learned simplicity. And of course, Paul Reno Jobs is his adopted father. Okay, Steve Jobs was given away at birth because the parents didn't want him. Okay, so Paul Reno Jobs, his adopted father, also taught him about excellence. So you can see Robert Noyce, Robert Friedland, Bill Campbell, Kobunji Otagawa, and Paul Reno Jobs. And because of this, what happened? Steve Jobs started to mentor some other people. So he mentored Mark Zuckerberg, your best friend. You know, everyone has his app, that Facebook founder. He also mentored Sergey Brin and Larry Page, which are Google co-founders. And of course, he also mentored James Fielding, which is the president of Disney Stores. You all know all these brands, right? No problem, huh? Okay, and because of that, what happens after that is Mark Zuckerberg, he mentored Rick Hoffman, which is the LinkedIn co-founder. Everyone know what LinkedIn is? LinkedIn? Okay, this one very few heads. Okay, doesn't matter. When you go to work, this is like the Facebook for work, alright? Your profile is inside there. LinkedIn is like a social platform for more serious stuff, okay? Facebook is where you put everything else, okay? And of course then, Sergey Brin and Larry Page mentored Marissa Mayer, who is the Yahoo CEO. For everyone knows Yahoo, right? Okay. So you can see how everything starts to join together. So where everything goes, and you have layers after layers of what it is. So really what we want to find out is that what happens is that, okay, you will find that sometimes mentorship relationships are formed in ways we don't expect. So we're gonna go and talk a bit about mentorship. So this is the first thing about mentoring relationship. Alright? So it is formed in a ways we don't expect. So meaning that for this guy, Robert Friedland, okay, how did he meet Steve Jobs? Anybody have any ideas? Read before the autobiography of Steve Jobs? Okay, so Steve Jobs was actually going on campus going from dorm to dorm to sell the computer, that time when they started off Apple computers. And what happened was he met this guy called Bill Campbell. This guy was actually in his dorm room with his girlfriend doing what a boyfriend and a girlfriend does in a dorm room, okay? So that is what they were doing, okay? And Steve Jobs walked into them. So they kind of stopped halfway and, you know, he said, oh, sorry, you know, they went out. But then somehow Robert Fridlin stopped what he was doing, and then he went out and then he talked to Steve Jobs. And that is how the mentor-mentee relationship was formed. There was no agreement, there was nothing else, but he walked in at the wrong time, but somehow it was also the right time now because he managed to talk to Robert Fridlin. Okay, so mentorship relationships are formed in ways you don't expect. So for each and every one of us, we need to understand that for us, we don't have to go to a special mentorship seminar. Don't go to a two-day course, then only you can become a mentor, things like that. It can happen in places we don't expect, all right? So what's gonna happen is we're gonna have a discussion, and I will start off the first question, and our chief will bring us through the rest of it, okay? So.
Okay.
Do you agree with this statement? You agree? Okay. So contribute. I caught this guy, but then he quickly changed. Okay, but yes. Oh, okay. You want to try it for now?
His
name is Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yeah,
that's good. Session, okay. So sometimes it feels like, although it feels good, sometimes it's just like presence. It feels very good when you're receiving it, right? But can you imagine if everyone has this mindset of I need to receive something, I need to receive something. So who's doing all the giving? Who's gonna do all the giving, right? I mean, like for example, you know, floods in Kelantan. Do you guys donate in any other way to people who are victims of floods in Kelantan? Anyone did some form of donation? Maybe you see someone sharing on Facebook, you click the share button also. I mean, in some ways you're helping also, right? So, anyone here study psychology? Yeah? Yes? Okay. Anyone study psychology? No? No. Where are you guys from? Are you IT students? Any IT students? Business students? Okay, a lot of business. Okay, money. Yeah. What other courses do you have in Kampang? Science, okay, what else? Engineering, okay, engineering students? Oh, okay, no wonder all the answers so cliche one. Okay, just kidding. Right, so in psychology, one of the needs, well, I won't say one of our basic needs, but it's really for humans, I mean, to survive and whatnot, for us to be part of society, contribution is actually one of the very important elements in it. Okay, so if, like I said, imagine everyone just wants to take something out of everyone, the cycle is just going to be imbalanced. Okay, so right now, okay, I was hoping there's some interesting topics here because do you know what the Sungai Long campus came up with, not some of the topics? Do you want to know? Okay, one of the guys said, actually he turned it around, he said, actually I want to be mentored on how to chase after girls. It's true, tell me, right? True, right? I wasn't making it up, true. But, so I'm looking at these examples, usage of lab instruments, arts and crafts, chemistry. I mean, it's nice to be mentored.
If not your girlfriend's hold this conversation, you know, against you,
How to achieve your dream?
Okay, for me, what I think is first you have to set a goal.
What kind of goal?
Depends on what you're doing. first you have to have a very clear what you want to do, and then after you can set a timetable how to achieve your goal by part, maybe by one day you can achieve 1% until the end. That's all.
So, you can ask more questions.
Another question.
What
is your dream?
Actually, I don't have any dream. I'm dreaming every day.
So, when you want to marry?
That's a good question. I think around 30 something.
So it's quite near already.
If you want to marry, you have to earn money first.
Yeah.
Then you have to have your own capital.
Yeah.
Okay. So
that's all.
Okay, Alan, are you a finance student?
Yes.
Okay, no wonder he talked about capital. I'm thinking like, huh, must be some guy from finance. Alright, okay, how did that go? Is it interesting? Can you see that sometimes the mentee did a reverse mentoring? Like he suddenly asked him about, how are your goals, you know, how about it? So this is actually the nature of mentoring relationship as well. Doesn't mean that if you're a mentee, you cannot ask questions. You can. Sometimes you can also ask your mentor some of the questions. It helped him think, you know, by asking when you're getting married. So Alan actually was thinking that maybe 30 plus because I need to, you know, have good finances and all that. So the relationship is very fluid. Okay, I just put a little bit of a guideline. Okay, you may have your own guidelines as well. That's fine. So how to be a mentor? Okay, keep it hot. Okay. Honest, open, and trustworthy. So for me, the first ingredient is really about that openness. Okay, there's no point going into a mentoring relationship when both of you are not sure. Maybe I want to share a little bit. Maybe I hide half of the my stories. I don't tell the person. It's not gonna work. Okay, because if you don't share openly, okay, maybe like for him, you know, he's ready to share. He's like, you know, have a timetable, have a dream schedule and all that. If he doesn't share, it's very hard for the mentor to help the mentee, right? And passion, okay? As a mentor, you need to have a passion. Do not ever be a mentor because someone told you to. Someone say like, okay, for example, Andrew, can you be a mentor to these two students? When Andrew's passion is maybe like, okay, you know, I can do it. But if it's not being done wholeheartedly, you're not 100% there, your mentee and you are going to end up wasting time because nobody's going to get the full, very fruitful discussion out of it. Okay, so please just identify, now, is this my passion? Do I really want to mentor someone? If you really answered yes, like for Alan, I think you're quite a natural mentor. You know, he's like, yeah, well, I don't mind, I want to be a mentor. So that's good. That's really your second step to it. And third, you put there curious as in you need to, having a mentee, you need to just be aware of his or her well-being, okay? So, of course, we say mentees should ask the questions, should come and approach the mentor. But sometimes, as a mentor, if you can sense, maybe, hey, what's happening to my mentee these days? You know, he looks a bit down. Then maybe you can ask. You can ask probing questions, okay? Sometimes they ask, how are you? Like, fine, okay? Not just like you guys, good afternoon, and good afternoon. So like what's happening? Of course I cannot ask everybody, but as a, you know, in the one-to-one relationship it's easier. So you can ask like, is your family doing okay? Are your studies okay? You know, is there something that's bothering you? I noticed you've been a little bit down this day. So as a mentor, to keep the relationship healthy, you need to ask questions. Okay? Good questions. Alright. Any questions about this slide? May anyone have any other tips on how to be a mentor? I may have missed out. Yeah. Any other, you know, elements that you think is very important before you go into this mentoring relationship? Yes. Knowledge, okay? Yes, Mr. Chin, right? Yeah. So knowledge, yes, one of it is knowledge. As you can see, you know, some mentors are maybe 10 steps ahead of you, but as a mentor also, you could be just 2 or 3 steps ahead of someone, you can already start mentoring the person, okay? So please, yes, knowledge is very important. If someone were to ask me, Svetlin, can you guide me on how to cook? I probably can't because, you know, my best dish is chow fun. I like fried rice, but that's all I know how to cook, right? Okay, what other things are you missing here? Any other tips that you want to share with me? Any other things that you find is very important? Anything? Okay, probably you might need to think about it, okay? Maybe after this session you come to think about it. But that's okay? All this process, it's maybe a little bit new to you. This is a new concept. Maybe you need some time to think about it, right? Okay, so our stories. Just want to share a little bit of my stories of mentoring relationship. So I have both. Okay. In my previous company, when I was with Shell, I used to have a mentor. So my mentor is actually a lady who is based in Netherlands. Okay, so Netherlands is quite far away. I think like about 12-11 hours of flight. Okay, so you might ask, so how did you get mentored? So our relationship is virtual. Okay, you use Skype, right? MSN, there's no longer MSN, okay? So we use something like a Skype, but it's an internal network. So it's a Microsoft Office Communicator. So I would schedule our meetup every once a month. So we will talk about my career, I'll talk about my personal life. I share a lot of things with my mentor. So how did I find her, okay? She is not my direct boss or my direct boss's boss. Okay. If you go to work in the future, if you go to work, you realize that the best mentor is someone that is not directly linked to you in your department. Okay. So, for example, I was in the department of HR. I can find someone in the department of IT or finance or engineering. That's fine. Reason being that your mentor can only be neutral. Okay. You need a mentor who's neutral, who doesn't know your colleagues. Because sometimes when I share stories about my colleagues, it's a bit sensitive. So imagine if I share stories about, let's say, my boss, and my mentor actually knows who's my boss. So my mentor might have a little bit of a mixed feelings or mixed opinions about it. Okay. So if possible, try to find someone who is neutral as a mentor. So that was how I experienced it. And how the mentoring helped me is sometimes when there are things where I discuss with my ex-boss, okay, when I couldn't really quite get the answer, I will bounce off ideas with my mentor. So your mentor is like an extra sounding board, okay? Just for example, now you have lecturers, right? If you're not too sure about the lecturer's responses and all, who do you go to? Is there someone else that you'll go to? Is it Google? Okay, so anyone that you go to other than Google is like a website, but anyone that you go to, it could be your part-time tutor, it could be your classmates. So those are something like your sounding board. You're asking for second opinion, right? So how that relationship helped me is she did not tell me exactly what to do, okay? So as a mentor, it's important to know that you are not giving your mentees answers. You don't say like, okay, your career, right? Okay, this 2 years you have to do this, the next 3 years you have to do that, and the next 5 years you're gonna be in the VP, you're gonna be a VP or HR or something. No, being a mentor is about asking the right questions, being supportive, and also just being like a, you know, like a guide along the way. Yeah. So don't, if you want to be a mentor, don't feel that you carry this huge responsibility that, oh, I have to help my mentee succeed. Okay, the mentee itself, herself or himself, has is accountable to pursue what he or her wants, and that's up to her, to him or her, you know, to achieve their goals. So the mentor is just there as a guide, as a someone there to be supportive of it. Okay, how I came into the mentor role is I went back to my university. We have an alumni network also. You have an alumni network in UTAR, yeah? Okay. Okay, so one of the activities that they came up with was a mentoring session from alumni to current students, yeah? So it's quite interesting because they actually pair us up with someone, I mentored someone who's a third year. Okay, she's a very bubbly girl, she's a third year in psychology. I think that's why we were paired up, okay? So it was a very interesting journey, because when I mentored her, I actually learned a lot about myself as well. You know, just now all the questions that we asked, questions like the camel picture, the nice Christmas picture, okay, so all this question was really for us to help you trigger your reflections. Because as you progress, right, you're quite bogged down with assignments and whatnot. Sometimes you have no time to think of things that you have learned. So for me, when I start to mentor her, I actually did homework. Before I go for our catch-up sessions, our one-hour coffee sessions and all, I always think about, you know, what can I bring to the table? What can I offer to this girl who came all the way 1 hour just to meet up with me? Yeah. So if you have a chance, it's a very, very good opportunity to be a mentor. It could be unofficial. You could just tell a friend, hey, I'm very good with guitar, you know, should I mentor you on guitar? That's fine, okay? At least you're doing something meaningful, which in the future, you, when you look back, you're like, oh, I didn't spend my uni days just playing Dota. Okay, so you can do something else rather than, you can mentor someone in Dota, you know, then you can go on and, is there like a Dota championship happening? I'm not sure. They're like, yeah, there is. Okay, yeah. Then you can mentor someone who might want to learn Dota, right? Okay, because that's his passion. You're passionate about Dota? Not really, okay. Okay, so that's my story. Okay, being a mentor and a mentee, so I've seen both sides. So maybe I'll get our team to share her story about that.
Okay, I actually have two stories as well. One is my experience being mentored during my university years, and another one during my career years. Actually, I just started working about a couple of years ago, so I'm still quite new from the university life. Okay, I would first share my experience during my university life. I was from University of Malaya, but my mentor, he's from Health College, and he actually studies psychology. So why I choose him as my mentor? We actually in this same organization, in the same club, but and he was like actually my senior. So he studied psychology, and I think his characters and behaviors actually I believe it can help me to become part of it, to become the person that I want to be, because he is such a positive person and a very visionary. So. He was a psychology student, but now he's like building his career in entrepreneurship doing coaching and training. So how he helped me throughout my university years was that every time I encountered a problem, or for example, I was very active in my university years, so I was very careful with the things that I wanted to do back then. For example, I wanted to join this conference, I wanted to take up this leadership position and whatnot, so I would consult him, and he would get me all through the way based on my behaviors and the concept of the conference, for example. Okay, so as a coach, as a mentor at the time, we were both students. He is also students, but I think he did the roles quite well. Like, he would ask me questions instead of giving solutions. And I like the way he asked questions and helped me to lead to some of these solutions, because he's such a positive person. Okay. And the second thing, when I started my career journey, I was from an accounting firm called Ernst & Young, but I was in the consulting department. So it was natural actually for each of us to have a career counselor. So instead of me choosing my career counselor, I was assigned to someone. But I really like my career counselor, because to me, she's also a good mentor, because she would always ask me questions instead of leading me on. For example, some counselor will just tell the counseling, okay, for the first 3 years, you just have to do this and this and this, complete certain hours of training, and that's it. But instead of doing that, she will ask me, so what do you want to learn? What kind of trainings do you want to undergo? And then, okay, so what have you learned for this quarter? So this kind of thing, and she would always take initiative to arrange like a slot to meet up with me, just to check out on how I'm doing and how can I progress or promote better for the next quarter, for the next week. So, and that's and even until now, I still keep in touch with her, because to me, though I have left the company, but the relationship is still there. She's much older than me, and I believe that she can guide me towards becoming the person that I want to be. Okay. So that's my mentor relationship story. Maybe Andrew would like to share his as well.
Okay, I've also got two stories. But I will share firstly, I think, from what happened to me from lack of a mentor. That's one story, and another one was the mentor story lah. So I think when I was in Form 6, how many of you did Form 6? Got a lot of you, huh? How many of you did Form 6 with 5 subjects? Last time got 5 subjects. Okay, alright. Wow, I see one lone hand there. Okay. So back then, Form 6 not so simple, right? We don't have English subject. So I did like pengajian am, you know, physics, chemistry. So chemistry is split organic, inorganic. You know, and physical, just the physical book is this thick, you know, inorganic and organic. I mean, you know lah, you can't read in Form 6. So it's not like in university, like when I went to university, one semester read, throw away. One semester read, throw away. Form 6 is 2 years, you know. So so what happens was, and I was also the head prefect, captain of the sports, the yellow team in my school. So yellow team, I was the captain. And then I was president of the Christian Fellowship. Then on top of that, I was the overall school head, and a few other things lah. So as you can know, Form 6 plus all these things is disaster lah. Okay. So what happened was, I didn't have a mentor to really tell me the key thing that I needed to do was focus, prioritize. As a result of that, looking back, I made a lot of decisions, firstly as a head prefect, which I felt that I didn't do properly. But more importantly, what happened was when the STPM result came out, I got a C, a D, a E, a R. R is a partial pass. Got two papers, one pass, one fail, and finally an F. That means two papers fail. So I think my pure math, both papers fail. My chemistry partial pass. So I literally failed my STPM in a sense. So in the sense that I got the slip, but I never got the cert. You understand? Because you kind of didn't, kind of partial pass in a sense. So I didn't get a full cert. So I was too embarrassed to even go back to the school. So that was like many years ago. I never, as a head prefect, school captain, yellow house, you know, everything, all these president of fellowship, you know, I represent the state, for debating, competition, and you know, this happened, I never went back. So I really look back, if I had someone to really talk to me, hey Andrew, can you drop some things or not, you know, don't be so gung-ho about everything, you know, concentrate a bit, you know, as it is, my studies are not that good, right? I'm not the type that can, I don't have discipline to study. So you guys in UTAR usually, before come out, already got job one, right, in a sense, lah, because you're very good at studying. So I was not one of them. But luckily, I learned my lesson, then I went to, still managed to finally get into UPM, and then I studied and did pretty well, and then finally I went into Shell for about 7 years, and that's... the side story here is, even if you fail, don't worry, there's still a way one. I didn't know anyone in Shell, okay? So I didn't get my, I didn't pay on my way into Shell. That's besides the point. The second thing is, I play guitar professionally. How many of you play guitars or instruments? How many of you play? Nobody plays instruments. Everyone here just cycle, everything just cycle. hobby cycle. What do you read? You know, I go to Facebook to join bicycle group. The Twitter, I follow Lance Armstrong, all those bicycle people. Everything cycle here, is it? No, and here also got theatre, I think Lotus, they got theatre, right? Please do some other things other than cycle, right? Okay, just joking around. So I after PMR, I actually learned up guitar, and I'm a self-taught musician. But then this guy in my church, he's Siti Noaliza's music director. Lucky lah, I mean. Lucky. So I play in church a bit here and there. So he saw me and say, hey Andrew, you're quite good, huh? Then I said, can I? Always normal, we all very humble, can. No, I'm not that good, you know? That's what we usually say. And what happens is that because I'm a self-taught musician, all the tauge, and all the music score, I know zero. So how he mentored me was, he said, hey Andrew, let me teach you some things. So how he mentored me was, after church, every time after he played, they will play the certain song. So I'll go to him, hey, give me the chart, the music chart, to show me. Then I say, oh, what is this? So this went on for about 2-3 years. So I was to play by ear with guitarist, so I play by ear. So whenever I hear something, I can play back already. It comes through a lot of practice. But my theory, theory is not there. So today I learned theory. So that was the mentoring relationship. We didn't have coffee or those kind of things. Once in a while, I go to his house, you know, to look at his home studio, wow, you know. But that's how it is. And because of that, I mean, I managed to learn and also opportunity opened. So later on, I got a chance to play for CJ Noriza, Jeffrey Victor, Vince, you know, JSP. You know JSP? Mentor people around you. And really, what happens is that you can take up initiative. You can see how simple it was, right? Just now, the two girls and the two guys up front, it doesn't require, I mean, do you think that we call them 1 week ago, we send email with each other, WhatsApp, you know, and so how, okay, this is what you say, first thing, this is the question you ask. We didn't plan anything, right? So nothing was planned. This is not like a reality show where everything is planned, even the voice, everything is planned, you know? So what happens is that reverse mentoring or mentoring itself can be very simple. Okay, so take up initiative and really learn to do some of these things. Really, that's why we're here. We hope that you will learn. And finally, it hits you, hey, it's not rocket science. It's very simple and it can be done. So we'll leave you with these few thoughts, okay? Alright, so we make a living by what we get. We make a life by what we give. So all of us got something to give. So let's learn how to give some of those things. And really, you don't have to be 20 steps, 30 steps ahead. Just one or two steps ahead, you can already really mentor. So really the question now is, what do you do next? So do you walk out of that and like, oh, okay, lah, 2 o'clock. I was surprised, I didn't fall asleep. Okay, lah, quite good, lah, quite good. Oh, I just now went 2 o'clock already. Or would you say, hey, they said something interesting. Maybe let's try. Let's try. What's the worst that can happen? Let's try a bit. You know, I look at friends, you know, hey, I'm very good at art and craft. So maybe I can just teach some of my friends what art and craft is about. And really, for most of us, we're not used to going to someone and say, hey, can I mentor you? We're not very used to that, right? Because Asian culture. But for us, the rest of us, I think it is more natural for us to say, hey, I've got a problem. Now, if I look back and realize that I had a problem with my studies, I would say, hey, you know, can you mentor me a bit on my studies or whatever? So for all of us, I think the easier way for us is if you know some of your friends who are good at certain things, whether studies or other things, just say, hey, can you help me out in this? And when someone asks you, can you help me out in this, most of us will not say no. Correct or not? But a bit more hard for us to like, hi, my name is Andrew, you are, you know, so and so, can I mentor you? Not natural, right? How many of you would go out there and start going around there? Hey, who are you? Can I mentor you? Not so natural, right? But we can start to ask a bit. And asking for help is not a sign of weakness. It's a sign of curiosity and wanting to learn more. Alright? So really, that's what it is. And, okay. So that is all we want to really speak about mentoring.